Now, this is really humiliating for me, huh? Prima ballerina Lisa Macuja is preparing to retire from the stage. Here's a look at Lisa's passion and her plans for a graceful exit.
Born in 1964, Prima ballerina Lisa Macuja began her love affair with pointe shoes, tutus, and pirouettes at age 8. Schooled under the Royal Academy of Dancing, she later earned a scholarship to the Vaganova Choreographic Institute in Leningrad, Russia, and became the first Philippine ballerina and first foreign soloist to join the renowned Kirov Ballet in 1984. Upon returning to the country in 1986, she became the first artist-in-residence of the Cultural Center of the Philippines. She danced with Ballet Philippines before performing as principal ballerina of the Philippine Ballet Theater. In 1985, she established her very own ballet company, Ballet Manila, helping raise the appreciation and art of classical ballet in the country. After a career spanning 27 theater seasons, this pride and joy of classical ballet poises to make her graceful exit from the stage. Next month, Lisa Macuja begins her Swan Song Series, 3 years of performing full-length classical ballets, her way of weaning herself from the dancer's life that she loves.
And joining us on Hot Copy today, Prima ballerina Lisa Macuja-Elizalde. Good day to you, Lisa.
Good morning, Karen.
Now, I'm shocked you're turning 50.
No, I'm not turning 50 yet.
You're not turning 50?
I'm turning 50 in 3 years.
Okay.
Yes, I'm turning 47.
Oh, no wonder. Okay.
Easing into retirement planning a 3-year retirement Swan Song Series period.
Okay. Yeah. Now, why retire?
Because it's high time. Okay. Usually dancers have a 15 to 20 season lifespan, career lifespan.
Okay.
I'm on my 27th season.
I see.
Already I'm overstaying, to speak.
No, I'm curious. Are dancers like boxers? Boxers have an age limit.
Mm-hmm.
And then they say it's enough. What mm-hmm. about dancers?
Well,
I would never think you're in your 40s or late 40s.
Thank you. Actually, because dancing is such a physical art form, we do depend on our bodies for, to express our art. And it's very athletic. We are called performing athletes. So, of course, the wear and tear of the body as we continue to dance.
Yeah.
For me, I'm already feeling it, stamina-wise. I've had already two surgeries.
Really?
Yes, to correct the wear and tear of my body. So I feel that it's time that I ease into retirement with a 3-year period. It's called my Swan Song Series. I'm launching it with Swan Lake and Romeo and Juliet next month.
I see. Okay. Mm-hmm. We'll be talking about that at length later. I'm curious, you said you've had two surgeries. For what?
For chronic tendonitis on both my ankles. That was done in December.
Okay.
And just 4 weeks ago, I had to have my plantar fascia released on my left foot because I ruptured it during a performance in London 2 months ago.
How taxing is it to be a ballerina? What is the life of a ballerina?
It's basically 6 hours of dancing every day to keep in shape.
Six hours?
Yes. And when you're on stage for, say, a four-act ballet like Swan Lake, you're on stage for almost 2 hours of non-stop dancing.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Now, do ballerinas eat?
Yes.
I mean, I'm just curious.
Yes, we need the energy to perform.
Black Swan. Was that accurate?
It was exaggerated.
Okay.
But yes, it does happen that, ballerinas abuse their bodies. They suffer from, eating disorders maybe. But you have to stay healthy in order to be an active performer.
Okay. Now, you started when you were 8. Mm-hmm. You knew already you wanted to be a ballerina.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, tell us about when did your parents want you to be something else?
Yes, my parents wanted me to be an accountant.
Okay, that would have been so boring compared to your life now.
Okay. That's right. When I was 14, I decided that I really want to try and become a professional ballerina.
Okay.
I was inspired by Japanese prima ballerina Yoko Morishita in a performance of Swan Lake in the Cultural Center of the Philippines. And I thought that if she's tiny, skinny, she's Asian, and she could excel in this Western art form, then maybe I could too.
Okay.
So that was when I decided that I'd like to devote at least 2 years of my life just to study and dance ballet and see if it was a viable career option for me. And that happened in Russia, and I did become a ballerina.
Now, being a ballerina and being called a prima ballerina are two different things.
That's right.
All right. Tell us the difference. Prima, you have to be given that title.
Yes. Prima ballerina, you have to have clocked, performances in the principal or the lead roles in the classical ballets, as well as the contemporary and modern ballets. You would have to have a principal dancer status with a leading ballet company for, you know, at least around 5 or 6 seasons in order to be called a prima ballerina.
Yeah. And in the Philippines, how many do we have? Just you?
We've had several. Okay. Over, you know, Mania Barredo was our first prima ballerina.
Yeah.
We've had several prima ballerinas. I'm, I guess, the overstaying one.
but is ballet an art form or a sport that a Filipina can be good at?
Yes.
Why aren't we known worldwide for it? Why is it that it's the Russians or other?
Because ballet as an art form is very young in our country. We're ballet in our country is maybe less than 100 years old, around 75, 80 years old.
Okay.
Whereas ballet, for example, in Russia is more than 250 years old.
Okay.
So we're just a baby in classical ballet. But we do have, we do have 3 professional ballet companies in the Philippines.
Yes.
And we are getting there.
Yeah. Now, you put up Ballet Manila. Mm-hmm. And do you get frustrated that you feel sometimes Filipinos don't appreciate it? I mean, what I'm trying to say?
We're trying to change that perception of classical ballet being an elitist art form that only the educated or the rich can enjoy. Ballet did start as an art for royalty alone. And we are, in Ballet Manila, our mission is to bring ballet to the people, because I believe that as long as you have eyes to see and ears to hear the music, you can appreciate ballet.
Mm-mm.
It is a universal art form. It is beautiful.
Yeah.
And it is very, very difficult to do and perfect. And if you watch a ballet performance, a good ballet performance, you'll get to like it.
Okay, so in Ballet Manila, you teach or you produce?
Mm-hmm. I do everything.
Everything.
I dance, I teach, I manage, I direct, I coach, and I market. I do everything. Yes.
Yes. Now, does it earn a lot of money here?
It's a viable profession.
Okay.
I do have I do employ 53 professional ballet dancers in Ballet Manila. Yes, and we are able to give year-round contracts to these dancers, and we are able to tour internationally.
Yes.
So they have, you know, they have a profession.
Okay. Now, the Swan series for 3 years, when you say series, I know it'll be Swan Lake.
No. It's a Swan Song series.
Okay.
So basically, it's my last performances in the big classical ballet roles that I've been known for
in
the past. Okay, so it's my, so coming up is my last performance in Swan Lake. And in Romeo and Juliet. Next year, it's going to be Don Quixote and Carmen.
Okay.
And perhaps Le Corsair. And then the year after that, it's going to be Nikia in La Bayadere, Princess Aurora in Sleeping Beauty. You know, the big, long classical ballets that are really hard to do.
Yeah. All right. Now, what is your favorite?
That's hard to say. When I was younger, my favorite was Kitri in Don Quixote.
Okay.
Because it's like a really flashy, happy ballet. That's so me. Now, as I get older, you know, the more sentimental, dramatic, romantic roles become my favorite, like Juliet in Romeo and Juliet, Giselle in Giselle, Nikia in La Bayadere. The hardest is Swan Lake, so that's the first to go.
Really the hardest?
Yes.
Because in Swan Lake, you become two characters,
yes,
right?
Yes.
You're the white swan and the black swan.
That's right.
Okay. And I didn't even know that.
Yeah, and Swan Lake was actually choreographed to be danced by two ballerinas, not just one ballerina.
Okay.
Which is why it's harder, because one ballerina has to tackle two roles, the white swan and the black swan.
Are you more of a white swan in real life or the black swan?
I'm more of the black swan.
Are you serious?
Yes.
You're the black swan in real life? Oh my God.
Well, the black swan is more of the fiery, temperamental, she's supposed to be a seductress.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, so you're a seductress. This is interesting.
No, actually, I'm a balance. But the thing is, as a dancer, I'm more of a technician.
Okay.
And I wasn't really characterized or typecasted or stereotyped as the soft, lyrical ballerina
okay.
that Odette, the white swan, is
yes.
supposed to
yeah.
be. I've had always a solid technique. I could turn fast, I could jump high, and that was what the choreography of the black swan, pas de deux, demanded
yeah.
from the ballerina.
Yeah.
So as a dancer, I was always more of the black swan as far as technique, stability, strength is concerned. But to be able to dance the white swan was the ultimate challenge for me.
Yeah. No, you're extremely articulate too.
Thank you.
I'm thinking now, if a talented dancer were poor, how would she get your breaks?
Well, you know, there are ballet scholarships, and foremost, yeah. For talented dancers. There's not enough. The Filipino dancer is very talented, and given the right opportunities, you know, it's still a very expensive art form to get into, because it takes like 6 to 10 years of daily training.
Yeah.
You have to have a good diet, a healthy lifestyle, and you have to have the equipment.
Okay.
And, you know, a pair of ballet point shoes, for example.
How much are those?
They cost 5,000 pesos a pair.
Really?
And I go through a pair in 3 or 4 days.
What?
Yeah, of dancing.
I cannot believe.
So
Are you serious?
Yes. It is an expensive art form.
No, but in 4 days, that's gone?
Yeah, because the humidity, point shoes are not, they don't last forever. They are, they have to be flexible enough and soft enough to be able to make your feet articulate in the shoe.
Oh my God.
And so in
like
order
20,000 pesos or 25 a month for shoes.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Well, for active dancers like myself, you know, student dancers and less active dancers go through them, you know, at a less rapid pace.
Yeah. But now, you have 2 kids?
Yes.
2 kids, you're a mother. Has it affected, it clearly hasn't affected her body. Look at her body. How did you lose the weight?
Dancing, really. I was back on stage performing when my son was 4 months old.
Oh my God.
And when my daughter was 5 months old.
You're normal.
Yes, normal delivery.
And then you breastfed.
Yes, I did.
But you're still so skinny.
I was, in fact, in my costume in Nutcracker, breastfeeding backstage in between Act 1 and Act 2.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Because I gave birth July of 1998. December of 1998, I was already dancing.
Oh my gosh. Is that normal abroad? Or when you start having children, you don't dance anymore?
We get maternity leave, we just get back into shape. And as long as the artistic director feels that you're ready to perform, then you're ready.
Yeah. Now, how many ab workouts do you do a day? I'm curious, because Manny Pacquiao said during a fight, it's 2,000 a day.
I don't do that.
You don't?
I just dance.
And you... Yeah. Is it genetic too?
No,
on your part?
It's because when you have the correct technique of dancing and the correct pulling up of dancing, a 2-hour ballet class and rehearsal is really a good workout.
No, I can imagine. All right, we'll be right back. We'll ask your questions for Lisa Macuja. Yeah, I'll go into gap first. So questions for Lisa Macuja when we return up next. Oh my God.